and therefore reduce the number of signatures required. I think that works around this, the statutory scheme that the General Assembly has enacted. However, after close examination, the statutes don't say specifically that you cannot have a one-person party. And so the board voted 4-1 to accept We the People, notwithstanding the important legal question. So that is something I think that the General Assembly should consider, whether they really want to have this two-tiered process. Because after this experience, I don't think anybody's going to try to be an unaffiliated candidate anymore at the statewide level. They'll simply create a party with whatever name they want to do and be subject to much lower petition thresholds. The story with Justice for All is entirely different. And I'm going to just hit the highlights here, and then, of course, I'll be happy to answer any questions. So at the very beginning, but even before the board took any action on this, county boards recognized or identified signatures that they believed were fraudulent. And so state board staff began a criminal fraud investigation, which is still ongoing. I'm told I can't talk about the details of that for obvious reasons, but suffice to say that a criminal investigation with respect to fraudulent signatures is ongoing. Then the board, at an open meeting, had various witnesses of the various parties, including Mr. Medelius, who is the chairman of We the People. And he advised us that there were only 4,000 signatures that were actually turned in by We the People, which left, you know, an additional 13,000 that came from somewhere else. The only place we know of that somewhere else was a group called POP, People Over Party. So if I say POP, you'll understand what I'm talking about. Mr. Medelius testified that a man by the name of Paul Hamrick from Alabama reached out to him and asked whether POP, could gather signatures on behalf of We the People. And Mr. Medelius said, sure, that would be fine. And they added three names, which would be able to turn in signatures. And by the way, they hired a firm out of Colorado. They, meaning POP, hired a firm out of Colorado called Blitz Canvassing, who in turn reached out and presumably hired signature gatherers. So we have a several level story. What we found from our initial review was that many of the people that said, whose names were on these pages, said they did not sign. So you heard Dr. Jackson say that, you know, approximately 40% of those that we surveyed said that they did not sign or didn't remember signing. But there were an additional 8, which amounts to another 16%, who said they were not told the purpose and intent of the party. And as you understand, that is a statutory requirement. They are required. Signature gatherers are required to inform the signatories of the purpose and intent of the new party. So now you have 40% plus 16%, we're well over 50% of the signatures in our survey that were inappropriate under the law, either fraudulently obtained or insufficient materials. It was that distinction between we the people and the other parties that raise questions of fraud. Now, in order to explore that more carefully, we subpoenaed both Mr. Hamrick on behalf of POP and the three gentlemen, or the three people, I think one was a woman, who are connected to Blitz canvassing, so we could get the names of some of the presenters, some of the petition gatherers, and they refused to provide any of that information. So this is what the board was confronted with, and it was because we believed that, one more thing I should say, we would have liked the board staff to have conducted well more than 250 calls. However, time constraints were very, very tight. We were already past the July 1st deadline, and there was a lot of pressure to get it done. And again, the refusal of the group that collected most of the signatures to comply. So, you know, I'll tell you my personal view is that if we interviewed 2,000 or 3,000 more, this would all be confirmed. And I think that's, you know, I don't need to say anything more about that. The one more thing I'd like to say, Mr. Chairman, and then I'll stop, is that we all want to follow the law. It is our obligation to decide these issues based on the law. And I understand the political currents here. I'm not naive to that. However, this decision was based entirely on the facts as I've just described them. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I, of course, invite all your questions.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. And we certainly hope that is the case as well. And we've got a series of questions, I believe. If you wish to be recognized to ask questions of the chairman, please raise your hand now. I see Representative Cleveland. I see Representative Warren. I see Representative Chesser. Representative Cervenia. All right, thank you so much. Representative Cleveland, you are recognized for up to 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. excuse me, Ms. Hurst, why did the board seek to conduct a random survey of the justice of all petition signatories, but not the Constitution or the We the People Party? I mean, you gave a vague reference to it. I need some specifics.
Well, The short answer, Representative Cleveland, is there was no evidence of fraud or misleading signatures with respect to those other two parties. And they collected their own signatures. I believe that We the People hired a firm as well. I'm sorry, I get them all confused. We the People, the Kennedy Party, hired outside signatures. But they monitored all that process. So it was the, and remember, we had a fraud investigation that was initiated by the county boards with respect to Justice for All.
So could you tell me who provided the information that gave you the implication that there was fraud?
County boards.
The county boards, nobody else.
You know, I don't know the answer to that, Representative Cleveland. I think the staff would have to answer that.
When was the decision made to survey the signatures?
I have to look. If you like, it was, you know, within a week before the board made a decision on the subject. If you need an exact date, I can dig through the papers here and find them.
I guess my problem is, if you had an indication it was fraud, why wasn't the decision made earlier on in the process?
Well, it was, Representative Cleveland, with respect to those particular issues. The criminal investigation had begun several weeks before. However, when we did our preliminary look and we found so many people whose signatures were on the these petition forms who said they never signed it, it raises itself to another level.
Okay. But you didn't decide until after the July 9th meeting to meet on July 16th. This was after the meeting that you decided to have a July 16th meeting. When was the decision made to meet then, and what prompted that decision?
Well, we were under a lot of pressure to decide everything as quickly as possible for any number of reasons. And that's why we only have 250 calls, because we had that very short window in which to make them, and a small and overworked staff to make those calls.
Well, you did a random sample with 250 people. You did calling between July 9 and July 11. You called during business hours, which I would think could keep people from answering the phone. And I just, what was the purpose of conducting the survey? You said you had an indication of fraud. Was it designed to produce some validity that there was fraud, or I don't quite.
It was to determine whether or not there was fraud, yes. I should, let me not say fraud, that because fraud indicates criminal behavior. And there, as I said, the county boards did identify some things they thought were criminal behavior. It was more a question to see whether or not the parties met the statutory requirement for signatures, both with respect to legitimate signatures as well as advising the people signing of the purpose and intent of the new party.
At any time, did you have an indication that even with this allegation of fraud, that the party would go below the 13,000 signatures required?
Prior to the 250 calls, is that what you're asking?
Yes.
No, we didn't. But prior to that, we did not know. We had a suspicion, but that's the reason we made the calls, to see what the results would be.
Okay. You know, are you familiar with non-biased or non-response bias?
No.
Okay.
Representative Cleveland, your time has expired. I am happy to add you back onto the follow-up, which would give you up to 3 minutes. Go ahead and add Representative Cleveland on there. Representative Warren, you were recognized for up to 5 minutes of questions.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Mr. Hurst, thank you for being here today. I have a couple questions based on some of your comments earlier. You had said that the CBEs kind of alerted you that they suspected maybe some fraud on the signatures that were turned into petitions on June 1st.
Yes.
Did I understand that correctly?
I'm not clear about the date, Representative, but yes, in general, yes, that's correct.
But it was the CBEs that alerted the board, is that correct?
I'm advised by State Board staff that is correct.
And yet at the same time, Mr. Elias's group, Clear Choice Action, alleged that 77 counties, 76 or 77 counties, hadn't even checked the signatures, is that correct?
I believe that's correct, yes.
Okay. So that was called to the board's attention by the Democrat Party via letter dated June 5th, and then by Mr. the Elias Law Group on June 7th. And then according to other testimony, staff was instructed, excuse me, the counties were instructed by Director Bell to verify the signatures. And they did that between June 14th and June 19th. Is that correct?
I believe that's correct, yes.
If they have validated those signatures by June 19th, what was the reason for having the survey done then in July? The signatures that were validated, I assume, met the minimum requirement of 13,000 plus. So that was confirmed on the 19th, but the board didn't meet till the 26th. Why didn't y'all just go ahead and follow the statutes and make a determination then? What was the motivation for pushing off a survey between July 9th and 11th?
Well, Representative Warren, I'm going to answer that in two ways. First, what the county boards do in validating signatures is just look to see whether the signature looks like the ones on file. And if you look at the signature pages, you can see a lot of the signatures are scrawls. They're just like little lines across, which county boards typically accept, because we all do that sometimes when we're signing. So there is still a need to determine in many cases whether or not the person who is claimed to have signed actually signed. That's number one. Number two is the statute requires that signature gatherers tell the person signing what the purpose and intent of the new party is. And county boards don't look into that. That's a responsibility of the state board. Fine. So we were checking for both.
So was that procedure used then when the signatures were validated by the counties for the Constitution Party and the We the People Party, or was it just on the Justice for All Party?
It was not done with the Constitution Party. And the reason for that is the Constitution Party submitted to us a one-page detailed statement about what their purpose and intent was, and testified that they provided that to people signing the petition. So we had a lot of comfort that everyone signing the Constitution Party knew exactly what the purpose and intent was. That was not the case for the other two parties. So we did a preliminary test, and after that preliminary test, We the People, the Kennedy Party, did not show a large number of people who said they did not sign. So it was with that preliminary test that led us to do a more extensive test of Justice for All.
In some respects, I really respect the fact that the board was as judicious as they could be in addressing some concerns, even if it does constitute a difference of validation process among the three applicants. The one thing that concerns me about the survey is that the survey took place after the signatures were validated, and yet in your presentation and part of the reasoning you had for the board had for denying the status for the application was that people, I think you said 18 people couldn't remember signing it or denied signing it, and yet their signatures were validated prior to that survey in which they said that, which skewers your percentages, as particularly when you extrapolate it out over 17,000, which is the assumption you all made. And I have to believe that if the same protocols were put in place for the Constitution Party and We the People Party, then you probably would have found some similarities there with people not remembering whether or not they signed it or what it was they signed. This process, to I think Representative Cervania's point, this process for collecting signatures is pretty random. I mean, whether you're standing out in front of a Walmart or, you know, wherever people are going to be in high numbers where you can reach the most people with the least effort, I think you're going to find people signing stuff that they don't necessarily recall 3 weeks later, particularly during a holiday season, to Representative Cleveland's point. I'd like to ask, the law and general statute is very clear that a party is any group of people that come in. You know the statute. It came up actually, I heard it come up in the July 16th meeting. There was a lot of discussion going on as to, among the board, some of the board members, as to the intent behind forming the party, whether it was to pull votes away from certain candidates. And it would seem to me to be common sense that the formation of any party, whether it's Republican or Democrat, is to pull votes away from somebody else. So I don't know, how does that figure into reaching a decision or in validating whether or not a group of people was a party?
Well, there are a lot of parts of that question. Let me respond this way, and then I'll fill in more if you have further clarification. We showed a video, I don't know if you all have seen that or not, of a fellow named Scott Pressler. Scott Pressler is a Republican activist who goes around the country, working on behalf of the Republican Party. And the Washington Post had a video of him soliciting people, we believe, at a Trump rally. And what that video shows, his explanation to the people that he was asking to sign this petition on behalf of on behalf of Justice for All, was that it would take votes away from Biden. And obviously that's not the purpose of the party. So he was, those signatures, if we could identify which people they were, would not be valid for that very reason. They're required that the purpose and intent of the party was at minimum to put Cornel West on the ballot. It wasn't to take votes away from Biden. But I understand your point about how any party is going to take votes away from somebody.
That's my point. I mean, regardless how Mr. West gets on the ballot, he's going to pull votes from somebody, just as surely whoever gets on the Constitution Party's ballot is going to pull votes from both parties as well. I just don't see where that's a significant factor. I do understand the implications of what you're saying with an activist soliciting signatures. However, you can't reach a determination on a group of people and disenfranchise a group of people with legitimate reasons for wanting a candidate on the ballot on the basis of one individual. If that were the case, we could throw entire police departments out for one errant cop, or teachers all out across the board for one misstep by one individual. I don't believe that's a legitimate reason, again, and I think it oversteps the bounds of what the responsibility of the board is in determining whether or not a group of people have met the legal requirement to qualify for getting on the board. You referred to the POP, as you call it, people over politics, asking to assist in collecting the votes, the signatures to get the ballot access. How is that different from any other group of concerned people to come up to another entity and say, can we help? Can we insist? Or anybody come up to one of us as a candidate and say, can we work on your campaign? The question would be, did POP follow the legal requirements for gathering signatures? Did their petition have the disclosures that it was supposed to have on it?
I'm sorry, is there a question there?
Yes, I said, did their petitions have the disclosures?
Oh, did their petitions, yes. I believe so. But again, the question is what they told the voters. And that's what we were trying to find, and that's what they refused to give us the information about the names of their petitioners, who turned in what. And had we had that information and had there been sufficient time, we would have examined those people to find out whether they did it properly. Because remember, the survey we did resulted in over half of the people reached.
So let me understand what you were asking of them. You want to know the name of the people who were actively taking clipboards and talking to people at random in the street, and you were going to ask them what they told people?
Yes.
I think anybody here could tell you on this board from our political experience that you're working with volunteers, and it's a random bunch of people that changes daily. It might have been impossible for them to know everybody that actually worked for them, but again, I don't know that that's within the scope of the board to get into the psyche of the people who were collecting signatures when it was clearly on, to your point, on their petition sheets, what they were signing for. What is the legal basis for this, the board's decision to second guess the county boards after they validated the signature?
I don't think we were second guessing the county boards, Representative Warren. I think instead we were doing our job, which was simply to see whether or not the statute was complied with, both with respect to had the people actually signed these petitions, and second, whether or not they were told the purpose and intent of the new party. I mean, I understand where you're going with this, Senator, Representative Warren. Sorry, I just elevated you to Senate. But the, I mean, the simple question is, were the people that signed it told the truth? Or did they, no, I'm sorry, first, did they actually sign it? And second, were they told the truth? And that's what we were seeking, and that's what we were unable to confirm.
Well, to my earlier point, and what you validated was this, the survey took place after the signatures were validated. So whether or not they actually signed it isn't, shouldn't have been the question. The question is, do they remember it? And is that important? They signed it at one point or another with the disclosure on top of the on top of the form. You did, I was going to ask you, I did know that you had a, the video shown. I was going to ask you what your intent was, but it's pretty clear. The intent was to demonstrate, and probably with good intention, that there was a political activist moving this petition along, or trying to get the petition signed for the intent of getting somebody on a ballot to pull votes away from another candidate, which we're seeing play out on a national level now since President Biden has stepped down from running. The Democrats are looking for the person who's going to draw the most votes away from Mr. Trump. So it's just politics. And I want to, before I relinquish any time that I've already overrun, I do want to say that I agree with Representative Cervania. You made a point that, and it came up in the conversations on July 15th, I'm sorry, that the parties might have been formed to circumvent the requirement of an individual getting 83,000 signatures versus the 13,800 some required for a party. Now, I think that's a valid observation. And I think what it tells us, and again, to Representative Cervania's point, maybe what you're, what we're learning from this is we pass laws, and I voted for this reduction of requirements to ease access to the ballot years ago when we reduced these requirements because we wanted people to have more access to the ballot. But it's a lot of times we see laws when we pass bill with the best of intentions that it's the implementation in practice that reveals some unforeseen circumstances. So maybe what we need to do is go back and revisit that, and maybe there needs to be some additional statutory requirements that qualifies what constitutes a party. And you brought up a couple of things. I won't get into it now because I'm terribly over my 5 minutes. But I do think that that's part and parcel of it. But to decide whether or not some group of people are going to be allowed to have a political party because their intent is to draw votes away, that's the purpose of the party. I don't think that's justification for not granting them status. And I thank you again for your time, sir.
Thank you, Representative. We go by my watch up here, so you were right under it. And so we're going to have a brief question from Representative Torbett. Then at 10:25, I think, is when they're supposed to do the blast outside. So we want, I felt the attention span in the room would get quickly pulled that way. So we're going to have a brief question, and I think we've got three, including myself, Representative Chester and Cervania, and then a follow-up right after that. Okay, Representative Torbett, you are recognized for a brief inquiry.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, thank you for being with us today, although it's digitally. Just a brief question is, I'm interested in responsibility, duties, and due diligence. Representative Warren was asking you about decisions at the county level, and who makes those decisions, whether the county level are acting within the law? Is that something that comes from the Attorney General's office, the Governor's office, the Board of Elections, the General Assembly? Who bears the responsibility of managing and making certain that county Board of Elections are following the law?
Representative Torbett, I think that that's a question that's probably best directed to Ms. Brinson Bell, who will follow me, you know, as the executive director. I think it's a complex answer. The state board has some responsibility, obviously any law enforcement. Well, let me not speak because
I'll wait when she comes online. Thank you for that. But I guess what I'm getting at is that if someone determines or at least believes or observes an infringement to law or a breaking of the law at the county level in either actions leading up to an election or during an election, I'm trying to find who has the ultimate responsibility to stand up and take those corrective actions. And we'll ask Ms. Bell when she gets up here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Again, I and others have a series of follow-up questions, but the committee will recess until 10:30.